What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous video of the series, we tackled matrices traversal and saw how by traversing the cells of a given matrix in a DFS manner, we can count the number of components in that matrix. But why did we use DFS? Why not BFS, for example? You see, you are free to use any traversal technique, but sometimes DFS will outperform BFS and sometimes BFS will be better. Why? And how do we identify these use cases? Well, DFS is good for searching vertices closer to the given source, whereas DFS is suitable when the target is far from the source. In BFS, we reach a vertex with a minimum number of edges from a source vertex. In DFS, we might traverse through and repeat a lot of vertices to reach a destination from a source. To expand on this further, take the examples we covered in our previous video. You see, in this first one, it doesn't matter which technique you pick because we will ultimately need to traverse all the nodes of the graph to mark them as visited and make sure that the components count is correct. Same applies to the previous matrix we saw. The cells belonging to the same island are close to one another. So BFS might be slightly better, but each cell is guaranteed to be visited once. So no matter which algorithm we pick, the number of cells to traverse will be the same. However, suppose we were asked to find a specific path inside a given 2D array or matrix and not traverse all the cells or count the components. Would both traversal techniques still have a kind of similar complexity? To visualize this, say you are given an n times n binary matrix containing ones and zeros only, and you are asked to return the length of the shortest clear path in the matrix. Note that a clear path is defined here as a path from the top left cell, i.e. the 0,0 cell, to the bottom right cell, i.e. the n-1 cell, such that all the visited cells of the path contain 0 and that all the adjacent cells of the path are 8 directionally connected, i.e. vertically, horizontally, and diagonally. The length of a clear path is the number of visited cells on this path. So, if we were to apply the DFS algorithm here, the implementation would lead to something like this. We will have to traverse every existing path from beginning to end. Then, after traversing all the paths, while keeping track of the number of cells we traversed for each path, the minimum length we are looking for will be the length of the smallest path among all the paths we went through. So we ended up traversing all the zero cells multiple times. Many of the cells having a zero value were traversed more than once. However, if we apply the BFS algorithm, it will look something like this. We will start by traversing simultaneously all the paths connected to our starting point, or in other terms, the first level adjacent to our starting element. Each iteration is marked in a different color here until we reach our target in red. As soon as we reach that cell, we don't need to look for other paths anymore, because we know that this is the shortest path to the target that is the solution we are looking for. You see, if the current level contains a zero, then we can hop to the following one. All we need to do is basically count the number of levels we are traversing before reaching the target cell. So, in this example, BFS allowed us to traverse all the paths simultaneously, making it advantageous to us over DFS. If you've watched our BFS video, you already know that BFS is associated with queues. Hence, to implement this logic, we will start by creating a queue. This queue will store the elements we are iterating over, which are ultimately the cells of the matrix, represented here by an array of two elements. The first one will be the row index, and the second will be the column index. You can also take a more object-oriented approach and encapsulate each cell in its own class or record. For now, the two-element array will do just fine. Now, this is going to play out similarly to any level traversal implementation. We will start by adding the first element into the queue. Then a while loop will keep iterating over this queue if it is not empty. Meaning, as long as this queue still contains elements, we will pull these elements one at a time and retrieve the corresponding row and column tied to the cell we just pulled. For each cell we pull from that queue, we will check if it is inside the matrix, and of course make sure that it wasn't visited before. This was done here with the helper methods you see in front of you, and should be straightforward. If these conditions are met, we will mark this cell as visited by making use of the values we have inside the cells, meaning the 0 will become a 1, as 1 represents the visited status here. We will then proceed by adding to the queue the 8 directionally adjacent cells to the current one. Okay, at this point we have the level order traversal, but what about our answer? We are still missing the piece that retrieves and increments the shortest path variable. At no point in this logic we are counting how many levels we went through before reaching the target cell. While traversing binary trees in a level order manner, we kept track of the levels we traversed by introducing a size variable, allowing us to treat each while loop iteration as a single level. If you never encountered the logic we just referred to, feel free to check the video linked in the card above. This is achieved here in a similar manner as you can see. This allows us to increase the shortest path variable we have every time we start a new while loop iteration, as it represents the start of a new level. The last thing we need to do is add a check on the target cell we are trying to reach. As soon as we hit it, we return with the shortest path calculated, and if we never do reach it, a -1 is returned. The link to the LeetCode problem we solved today can be found in the description below. Let me know your thoughts and suggestions for upcoming videos in the comments section. And that's it for today. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.